together, let's explore the fancy side of MATLAB's data visualization capability. In fact, this colorful, impressive MATLAB-generated fractal volcano picture is a combination of a 3D surface plot and a contour plot. MATLAB offers a good variety of three-dimensional plots to meet our visualization needs. As one would expect, in a three-dimensional space, in addition to X and Y, we should also have a third dimension, which might be representing height, might be representing time, and etc. The relationship among X, Y, and Z determines the most suitable type of the plot. I'll use examples to show you how to generate line plots using function plot3 and how to create surface plots such as a mesh plot using function mesh and function surf to create a surface plot, and then a contour plot use contour function. And then you have something similar to the volcano plot where surface plot is combined with a contour plot. And in next recording, we're going to have more fun using MATLAB generating 3D shapes. And the function to use is simply cylinder and sphere. So we can use cylinder function with different parameters to generate a 3D prism, a vase, a pyramid, and we can use the sphere function to create a ball. Although learning how to use these functions are important, a more important question is to understand how to choose the right type of 3D plot to visualize your three-dimensional dataset. So let's keep the two questions in mind. One is how to use these functions, and the other is how to choose the right type of 3D plot. So the first question is when to use 3D line plots and when to use a surface plot. The 3D line plots are most useful when you have two related dependent variables change along the same independent variable. For example, we might have the position of the object on a 2D plane indicated using X and Y change according to the third dimension time. A surface plot is most suitable when you have a single variable that is a function of two independent variables X and Y. So Z is a function of X and Y. This will become obvious when we look at the examples. So here I have an example with one independent variable X generated using lean space, which is a function produce equally spaced values within a range. So the first two variables specify the range. So it generates a set of values between 0 and 10 pi, and the third variable indicating how many. So this line of code will generate 1,000 x values between the range of 0 and 10 pi inclusive. And then I have y values defined as cosine x and z values defined as sine x. So if we don't plot the x dimension, instead we plot only y and z, you can imagine that we are plotting a circle on the yz plane. But if we stretch it along the x-axis, then you can see we produce a spring-like picture in this three-dimensional line plot. So here is the same example in MATLAB. Let's run it. And as you can see in the figure window, we have a spring-shaped 3D line plot. The x-axis is the independent variable angle, and the y-axis is the cosine x, and the z-axis is the sine x. We can turn the rotation on, so we can have a look at the flat view, the two-dimensional view of this 3D plot. As you can see, the cursor becomes a rotation handle, and you can hold on to the picture and then view it from different angles. And you right click, you'll be able to go to the xy view. As we can guess, the xy view would be cosine x, the shape of a cosine wave, and then the xz view will be the shape of a sine wave, and the yz view would be a circle. So let's see, let's verify it. So this is a cosine wave, and then back again, we go to the xz view would be a sine wave, and then yz view is a circle. An interesting variation of plot 3 is comet 3, which does exactly the same kind of line plotting in 3D, but it animates the drawing process. The same as plot 3, it takes in x, y, and z, and the x and y are dependent variables on the single independent variable. Let's change plot 3 to comet 3. For the same example and see how the animation worked. Run that again. So if you really want to see how your plots are generated, you could use this animated version of plot 3. For 2D plots, you have the comet function.
Here's another example illustrating 3D line plots. So firstly, your independent variable is now time.
You could think of your x and y indicating a trajectory of a moving object in a two-dimensional space. Imagine you have a pendulum moving in a one-dimensional space. Then it follows a cosine or sine curve. But now we have the pendulum moving in a two-dimensional space, following a circle.
And at the same time, apply some friction through this damping variable.
Then you have this circular shaped spiral stretching along the timeline.
So let's have a look at this example in MATLAB. I have my time goes from 0 to 10 with a step of 0.1,
and then I have my x as a cosine wave multiplied by a damping factor. You can imagine that my cosine wave will gradually die down as time stretches into future.
So if I plot only my x against time, then I should have a decayed cosine wave. And similarly, if I plot my y against t, I should have a decayed sine wave.
And finally, if we plot this in a 3D line plot, we can have this two-dimensional oscillation in the shape of a decayed spiral stretching along the timeline. So if we go to the XY view, you can see a spiral shape.
So coming back to our slides, 3D line plotting is nothing more than drawing a set of points in a three-dimensional space together. So we have the two, that's 100 elements, and then x would be also 100 elements, and y would be also another 100 elements. So you have three vectors, so the x, y, z.
Each vector has 100 elements, and the corresponding element with the same index are used to specify a point in a three-dimensional space. So for example, the starting point would be somewhere around 0, so 0 on t, and x would be cosine 0, that's 1, and y would be sine 0, that's 0, so that would be 0. Draw the line like this. So that's your starting point. So that's really how these different points get linked together in this 3D line plot. Okay, so there will be 100 points on this line, and then using line plot, they're joined together to create that 3D shape.
So now we know a 3D line plot is very useful in capturing two-dimensional motion along a timeline. So in contrast, a surface display is most useful when you have a variable z varying along two independent variables. variables, x and y. Think about the height of a mountain. If we assume the base of the mountain is where z is equal to 0, at each combination of x and y, the height of the mountain is a specific value. So that's why we're saying z is a function of x and y. So whenever you can express your z as a function of x and y, then you can use surface plot. There are two types of surface plots in MATLAB. One is the mesh plot, the other one is the surf plot. You can think of a mesh plot as a wireframe or a roof structure before the roof tiles are laid. And after the tiles are installed or the gaps are covered up, then you get a surface plot. And if you slice up a surface plot at regular intervals with the xy plane and project it downwards to a flat surface, then you have the contour plot. All three of them took three arguments, and we'll explain what are they using examples. The simplest surface plotting is when you have only one single argument, like this one. So z is a two-dimensional array or a matrix, and by default the xy values are the row index and the column index of z. So let's take a look at this example. I have a two-dimensional array, a 3x10 matrix, and I call the mesh function on z. So essentially this is the same as mesh 1 to 10, 1 to 3, and then z. So let's verify this in MATLAB. I have the same 3x10 matrix z, then I use the mesh function to plot z inside a subplot so we can compare the two results with each other. So for the second plot, I have a 10 element vector as its first argument, which representing the column indices of my matrix, and then I had the row indices as the second argument for y axis, and then for z axis I got the original matrix. So if we run it, you can see it produced exactly the same mesh plot. So coming back to the slides, mesh plot is also about connecting points in three-dimensional space. So we have a 10-element vector for x, in this case, from 1 to 10, and vector y, a 3-element vector, and then z is a matrix of 30 elements. So what MATLAB did was it paired up x and y's so that for each value of z, there's an x and y value corresponding to it. So for example, the first element of z will have x equal to 1 and y also equal to 1. And then the second element of z will have x equal to 2 and y equal to 1. A third element will have x equal to 3, y equal to 1. So for any value in z, the default x value would be its column index, in this case 6, and the default y value will be its row index. So let's verify this from the graph. When x is equal to 6, y is 2, we have this point here, and at that point, z should be 12. So if we draw a parallel line, find out z, it should be somewhere around here. So what I'm trying to illustrate here, mesh plot is also about connecting points in 3D space, similar to the line plot that we have seen before. So all these points here are corresponding to the indices. So this is 1, and that's 2, and that's 3, and that's this one is 4, and that one is 5, this one is 6, that is 7, that is 8, and that is 9, and 10, and etc. When x is equal to 1, y also equal to 1, the height is 1, is equal to 2, y equal to 1, the height is 2, and when x is 10, y is 1, the height is 10. When x is 10, y equal to 2, the height is then 20, which is that value from z. When we know the values of x and y, we can plot against those values instead of the index numbers. The number of x values needs to be the same as the number of columns of matrix z, and the number of y values needs to be the same as the number of rows in z. Once we know the mesh plot, a surface plot is just a mesh plot with all the gaps covered up by a sheet of fabric. As you have seen from my previous attempt of reading the xyz value of a particular point on a mesh plot, despite its fancy looking, surface plots are not very easy to read. So very often a contour plot is much easier to interpret than a 3D plot. Before computers are widely used for plotting graphics, it is quite difficult to plot a 3D surface. Contour graphs, on the other hand, are the most popular classic way of visualizing peaks and valleys, and is often referred to as topographic map, often used by hikers. It makes the visualization of peaks and valleys fairly easy on a piece of flat two-dimensional paper. How is it done? A contour plot is achieved by slicing a XY plane through this 3D surface at regular intervals. So where this XY plane has the property of Z equal to a constant. The surface outline where the 2D plane intersects with the surface is often called the level curve, and this level curve gets projected downwards to this XY plane to get a contour. And when we're slicing up the surface plot at regular intervals with constant Z values, and then we had eventually created a contour plot. Each contour in the contour plot represents a constant Z value, which means if you walk along the same contour, you stay on exactly the same elevation. And that's why it's very useful for hikers. And also the gradient is always perpendicular to the contour. The closer the contour is, the steeper the slope. So far we've been looking at defining the value of z. It'll be more interesting if we can calculate the value of z based on x and y. Before we show you a more interesting example, let's have a quick summary. For all surface plots, z can be expressed as a function of x and y, two independent variables. So to find out z, we first need to know x and y. There are three ways of defining x and y in MATLAB. Firstly is by default. So if we supply only one argument to a surface plot function, MATLAB automatically figures out the x and y based on the indices of the z matrix. Let's assume the z matrix is a m by n matrix. Then the default x in this case is 1 to n, and the default y in this case is 1 all the way to m, the row indices. The second example we look at is where you defined x and y and z, but x is a vector of n elements, and y is a vector of m elements. So the length of y is the same as the number of rows of matrix z. The length of x needs to be the same as the number of columns of matrix z. And the third way of defining arguments for a surface plot is where all three arguments have the same size. So in that case, you have a matrix X, M by N, a matrix Y, M by N, matrix Z, also M by N. And what MATLAB will do, it will match up the elements of the same indices from each matrix and plot them as points in three-dimensional space. So just like lane space, which create linearly spaced values on a single dimension, mesh grid, as its name suggested, will create a grid of values in the XY plane so that these nodes can be used as XY pairs to calculate the corresponding Z values. It takes two arguments. Each of them is a vector, so X could be a vector of N elements, Y could be a vector of M elements, and then mesh grid will create two N by M matrices. So let's take a look at this example here. So I have the values of X goes from minus 2 to 2, and the same for the values of Y. So each of them is a 5 element vector. So feeding them into mesh grid, we have two 5 by 5 matrices generated. As you can see here, X is a 5 by 5 matrix, and Y is also a 5 by 5 matrix. So if you try to visualize this in a three-dimensional space where you have X and Y, so your X starts from minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, and 2. Y starts from minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2. So if we're pairing up X and Y, so the first, let's have a look at the first row and then it'll become easier. So the first row, X goes from minus 2 to 2, and the corresponding row in Y has the same value, minus 2. So essentially, if you plot the points in this XY plane, X value is minus 2, the corresponding Y value is minus 2 as well, so we have minus 2, minus 2, that data point, and X is minus 1, Y is still minus 2, X is 0, Y is minus 2, and X is 1, Y is also minus 2, X is 2, Y is still minus 2. So we have pretty much 5 data points on Y equals to minus 2. And similarly, for the second row, you would have 5 points on Y equals to minus 1, and etc. So altogether, you have 25 points equally spaced on this XY plane. Prepare this XY plane so that you can find corresponding Z values for this 25 points. And then we can use these X values and Y values to calculate the corresponding Z value. In statistics, a normal distribution is quite common, and this normal distribution is often called a Gaussian distribution. So now I have a two-dimensional Gaussian expressed using this exponent, and then multiplied by the values. Take a note of this dot syntax, so we're doing element by element calculation here, and then we can plot using the mesh plot, the surface plot, as well as the contour plot. So let's run it in MATLAB. I have two 5x5 matrices generated using mesh grid covering the XY plane so that we can work out the corresponding Z values, and then I have Z as a two-dimensional Gaussian multiplied element by element by X, and then I have subplots to demonstrate the different kinds of 3D surface plotting that we have seen before. The only function that we haven't seen is this surf C, which is a combination of surface plot and contour plot. So let's run it. So you can see this familiar 3D plotting, a bit sketchy because our intervals are quite big, so we're not drawing as many points as one would like to see in a smoother surface plot. So we could put this as 0.01, a smaller step. Run that again. You see you're getting a much better surface plot, and in fact the surface plot becomes all black because the grid lines are so close to each other, and then they become inseparable and you see it all as black. So we could be less aggressive. So the black, all these meshes, the wires, when they're so close to each other, you can't see the surface color. All you're getting is the wire color. So finally, we can use the function color map to change the default color scheme. The default color scheme is jet, and we can change it to something like copper. Or other ones such as spring. And obviously, once you have spring, you have autumn. And you can change it to cool and hot color as well. So if you want to learn more about the default color scheme, you can use doc color map to bring up the documentation of color map in MATLAB. And we can see there's a set of predefined color maps, so you can use them straight away inside the color map function. You can define your own color map, and a color map is just a color lookup table, which is a matrix that can have as many rows as you like, but it must have three columns. So officially, a color map is a m by 3 matrix, where m specifies the number of colors in your color scheme, with the three columns corresponding to the RGB intensity of a particular color. So if you're even more curious about how MATLAB did the coloring, you could look at the documentation on coloring mesh and surface plot, and in particular this direct and scaled color mapping. Two very simple techniques. The first one is direct mapping, which uses the value of your dependent variable Z to determine which color to choose from your color map. So a value of 1 will point to the first color in your color map, and a value of 2 will point to the second color, and etc. And a scaled mapping does some simple calculation. It first worked out the maximum and the main values from your Z to control the mapping. So the minimum specifies the data value to be mapped to the first color, and the maximum will specify the data value to be mapped to the last color in your color map. So in MATLAB, we could display the color map. Let's choose autumn. You can see it's a 64 by 3 double array, which means in this autumn color map, it defined 64 colors, and each column represents the amount of red and the amount of green and the amount of blue mixed up together. So for autumn, there's basically no blue component, all blues are zero, and all red are one. So the autumn color would vary smoothly from red through to orange and finally to yellow. So I pretty much went through all these slides. And you can play with color maps to see how the colors could change the perception of your 3D surface plot.